Most cults demote Jesus to something lesser than God, and they demote Jesus' death on the cross and take away its effectiveness to pay for our sins, and they preach works salvation instead of salvation by grace through faith. This is People of the Free Gift, where we ground believers in their identity in Christ and equip them to reach those caught in religion. If you're new to the channel, go ahead and click that subscribe button so you don't miss any future content on the cults and how to share the gospel with them effectively. And so, like I said, we are going through our third wave of my book, Sharing Jesus with the Cults, available on Amazon as paperback or Kindle. The first wave, we went through the three sections: what is a cult, overview of the cults, and six tactics of how to share the gospel with them. The second wave, we went through specific chapters or clumps of chapters, working our way through the book. And all of those videos are available for you to watch. In this third wave, we are going back through the most popular of those different waves and those different videos that we've done. And we are breaking them down even further. And so we are taking the common characteristics of a cult and cult leaders videos, and we are breaking them down. And so we talked about how cults, they lower the position and authority of the Bible, and then they claim personal revelation from God, and they claim that they are, because of that, the one true church. Today we're going to talk about how they deal with Jesus, because most cults, not all of them, but most cults will find a way to demote Jesus. They will demote his identity, his personhood, and they will also demote what he actually accomplished or why he actually came to the earth and what his mission was and what that means for us. And that affects, in turn, the teaching that salvation is not by grace, but in fact it is by works. And so let's go ahead and dive into this. And so they demote Jesus as something lesser than God. If you're talking about the LDS Church, the Mormons, they believe that he is the firstborn spirit child of our heavenly Father in God, Elohim. And so they believe that all of us are spirit children, that every single person who's ever lived is a spirit child, was a spirit child first of Heavenly Father before we are sent to earth with our earthly bodies as our next step in progressing towards exaltation or godhood. And Jesus, as the firstborn, he was also a spirit brother with Lucifer, and both of them put their plans forward as to the plan of salvation. Jesus was chosen, his plan was chosen, he was chosen as savior of the world, and so then he went on to accomplish that mission, and he has since risen to the position of exaltation in godhood himself. But, and then obviously Lucifer, he gathered other spirit children and rebelled against Heavenly Father, and then he was cast down to earth without body and forever stunting his progression. And so now his mission is to take as many of us with him as possible. And so that's what they do with Jesus. And so obviously he is not equal with God. He is a separate being, separate God, and lesser than our Heavenly Father. The Jehovah's Witnesses believe similarly that he is the first creation of God, which actually goes back to the Council of Nicaea and the teachings of a man named Arius, and which those teachings were condemned at the Council of Nicaea as heresy. And the Jehovah's Witnesses believe that ultimately he was right, that Jesus was the first creation of God through whom he created everything else. And so he is lesser than and not equal to God. And in fact, they believe he is known in the Bible as Michael the Archangel. And so the Scientologists would just flat out say Jesus is a myth. And there's many others out there who claim this, that Jesus never actually existed, that everything you know about him, have heard about him, is completely made up. And that it's there for moral purposes, or it's there as an exaggeration, or it's there as a partial representation of something that was true. And the Scientologists believe this. They believe that all of us are souls called the Thetans, and that we are actually deities, but we have been tricked into submission to this greater power who has come and infiltrated this. And part of this plan was to sit us down in front of movie theaters and brainwash us with this propaganda about God and Jesus and Satan and everything that we know about different religions and everything else. And so some of us follow Jesus, and some of us follow Buddha, and some of us follow, you know, Muhammad, but they're all actually myths. They don't actually exist. They're just an illusion that has been perpetrated on us and created for us, and that's Scientology. Then you also have Christian Science that says that Jesus, and this is in their glossary in Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, it says he is the highest human corporeal concept of the divine idea, rebuking and destroying error and bringing to light men's immortality. And so they separate Jesus, the person, and Christ, the Christ consciousness that came upon Jesus. And of course, that idea also goes back to early heresies in the Christian church as well. And so those are some of the ways in which they demote the personhood and identity of Jesus. The way they demote Jesus' death on the cross and take away its effectiveness and to pay for our sins, and therefore teach salvation by works and not by grace through faith, is that Jesus makes it possible for us to be saved. And a lot of them use this language, that Jesus' death, they would say, is essential, that salvation would be impossible without it, but it did not actually pay for our sins. It just, you know, for the LDS person, they would believe that it made all of us, you know, his resurrection made all of us eternal. And so we all get to go to heaven. It conquered, you know, physical death for us. And so we all go to a level of heaven, but the level of heaven that you go to is determined by the life that you lead and the law that you follow. And so, and the ordinances and covenants and everything else that you keep. And so that is the way that they deal with that. The Seventh-day Adventist also uses this language of possible. He made it possible for us to be saved. But ultimately, it's by the keeping of the Ten Commandments and the Sabbath in particular and the different good deeds and the type of life that you've lived that ultimately determine whether or not you are considered worthy to go to heaven. And Jesus is currently in heaven and doing what they call the investigative judgment, going through the files in heaven and determining who is going to be ultimately worthy to live with him and his Father in heaven. And so then you have Jesus rose so that all will go to heaven. And this is something that's kind of like a universalism belief and a denial of a biblical concept of hell, a denial of all of those things. And so some would say that everybody is saved. Some would say it teaches annihilationism in which, you know, those who don't get into heaven, they're just annihilated and there is no conscious suffering as a punishment for their sins. And Jesus' resurrection was not physical and bodily. And this is something that the Jehovah's Witnesses teach. And that literally they believe, even in Jesus' case, that it was a separate creation. It was a reconstruction by God the Father of Jesus' body, that his physical body didn't rise, but that it went straight, it dissolved, it just disappeared and went to be with Heavenly Father. And so that obviously they put Jesus dying on a stake instead of a cross. And then they say that the way that we teach the resurrection is false as well. They change that. And so they do that as well. So resurrection for the Christian Scientist is spiritualization of thought, a new and higher idea of immortality or spiritual existence, material belief yielding to spiritual understanding. And so it's not something that it physically happened in any way, shape, or form. It's all spiritual. And there are some, like the Jesus Seminar, who said that Jesus never really physically rose from the dead. But they say that he rose within the hearts and the minds of those who believe in him. And that's how they would deal with the resurrection. And Christian Science has a similar viewpoint to that. And so then you have another, that Jesus died and rose so that you can be healthy and wealthy. And that would be, in the groups that are discussed in my book, more leaning probably to the New Apostolic Reformation and probably to a certain extent within the United Pentecostal Church International, the Onest Pentecostals. And so if you have an insight or a question that I didn't deal with or discuss, please do so. I put that in the comments down below, and I'll be taking some of those for next week's Q&A. And if you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe to the channel and give us a thumbs up on this video if you like the content for today. And share this with other people in your life who want to share the gospel with those who were caught in religion. And until next time, may God's grace be with you.